Hey everyone, I am Tom Sorensen, aka Moovieboy, and we are now in the second of three parts of how we did our science fiction spaceship composite. So, if you haven't seen part one, I'm kind of wondering what's wrong with you. You should always do one before two. I mean, you know, radicals are fine, but go back and do part one if you haven't already done part one. And now, hey, welcome to part two. So here's where we get into the nitty gritty, because now we need to build our spaceship and we need to composite her and the screen graphics we did in part one and make it all work. So away we go.
Moovieboy!
Okay, one of the initial things we can see here is that this got really dense really fast. So here are all the layers that we currently have for just this one shot. It happens. Let's take this one step at a time. At the very beginning, this was just a green screen shot that we set up in the kitchen with a few lights and a dolly shot in. Now, to just give you guys an idea of how low budget this was, the dolly shot was actually just my son's spy toy, which had some wheels, on which I put my Nikon, put that on a 2x4, and pushed that forward. So, yeah. Problem with that, of course, is that it turns out that it's a very unstable shot, and as I was starting to do the first renders, you can clearly see there's a bit of wobble. So, problem number one, how do we get rid of the wobble? So, one of the first things I had to do was to apply the warp stabilizer onto it and get that to be much smoother. The warp stabilizer is a really good plugin. It doesn't solve everything. It ran much more smoothly and then moved on to the next piece. What we need to do now is to create a 3D camera that can take the information from our moving dolly shot and incorporate that into our composition. So for that, we need the 3D camera tracker. Again, this is another great plugin. It won't solve everything, but it will usually do a great job at figuring out your 3D camera and create all these tracking points you see. But there is something to watch out for. If the error is greater than one pixel, your camera results are not going to be that great. And again, I realized that because she was moving in the shot, it also threw off the camera tracking data. So again, I used that mask of taking her out, did it again, and got a much better result and a much cleaner camera track. Now that we have all this 3D camera data, we need to create our 3D camera and a bunch of nulls and solids that we can then use to anchor our 3D objects for the composite. Now, in my case, I've already created a camera, but here is the button you would click to create your 3D camera. And let's choose some of these points here. And as you can see, we create a bullseye, a target, that appears to work on the same plane as our actual cabinet that's in the shop. So we can right click on those and create solid. And look at that, we now have a 3D plane. And now we'll create some more of those. Now we've got a whole bunch. Even though I had applied the warp stabilizer, it turns out that the camera move was still a little wobbly. So what I chose to do was to look at the position data in the 3D tracker camera. As you can see, it creates a keyframe on every single keyframe. So what I wanted to do was to select all of those keyframes and then go under Window. If you don't already have it open, go down to Smoother. And I just closed mine, so I'll reopen it. And I thought I would use a setting of 5 pixels to change the tolerance. And I hit apply, and look, it removed a lot of those keyframes and smoothened out the motion. And it created an effect that was a lot better for this shot. As I ran it through a couple times, it looked a lot better. And now with that taken care of, it was time to deal with the green screen and bring her out. If you start typing key light, and many of you have probably already seen this, but they've actually kind of bundled three effects together, where you have key light plus a key cleaner plus an advanced spill suppressor. And when you double click that or drag that in, it will actually start up all three of these. And there are plenty of tutorials out there about how to key in After Effects, so we will kind of skip over this section here. And then I worked on cleaning up that key and an advanced spill suppressor here
to help get that green out of her hair. As you can kind of tell, the composite that I've got here is actually of a very different width. I'm actually kind of creating my own fake anamorphic by creating a comp that is 2,540 pixels by 1080.
I just thought it was a lot wiser to expand on the canvas as opposed to taking the HD shot and cropping in on it. And this leads us to the next step.
Kid bashing.
So, what is kid bashing? Well, I'll tell you, in the olden days, if you were asked to make the Millennium Falcon, or a Star Destroyer, or to make the Death Star, oops, be careful there, especially if you're going to keep breaking things. Well, you just couldn't go down to the model shop and ask for a Star Destroyer model. You had to make it yourself, which meant you took pieces from all these other models and you went to town like a kid with a big old box of Legos. Oh yeah, look at all those pieces, baby. Oh yeah, you bashed that kit. Well, the same thing applies today. So I took this Vega Strike Starship bar from TF3DM and I looked at all the pieces and I went, hey, I can make a starship from this. So here were all the walls and windows from that original one, and I reconfigured and arrayed them around to make my starship. And then I looked at the ceiling tiles and I went, I can use some of those. And I applied that along with custom building my own lighting fixtures. Then I got a whole bunch of props from all over that site. I got my own katanas, I got my own guitars, I got my own goggles. And remember, you cannot take on the universe without your own towel. I took the bar section of this room, converted it, did some bend modifiers, put in some keyboards and some lights, and created my own little desk. Oh, and remember that spaceship from the holograms? Well, inside were seats that I then turned into my captain's seat. And then the floor? Well, I just kind of made my own floor, decided why not. And then I took some pieces from another model and made my own holograms. Oh, and I even took a model of Megan Fox and fitted her to be my placeholder for where my captain was. So now I just put all those pieces together one by one, layer by layer, and I had my own 3D starship, baby. Oh, yeah. Look at her. Look at that starship. Starshipping all over. Now, the big thing was to bring it into Element. So after I imported the model, well, let's just say that along with all those layers, I had a lot of materials. But I wanted control over each one because I didn't want some part of the model to suddenly be sticking out or glowing or not looking right. So that meant having to do a lot of texturing work. But trust me, it paid off to have that level of control, I think. Now comes the hard part, where I need to make this 2D shot of our actress look like she's actually sitting in that chair on a 3D set. So this is where those 3D solids we created with the camera tracker data come in handy, because she is a 2D element. If we were to change the cameras to different angles, we start losing her. But we retain the 3D solids. So I brought in the spaceship from Element 3D. And one of the first things I did was I created a group null, which then I would drag that null around and scale it and drag it back and forth until things started to look at the right scale. You just kind of eyeball it. I mean, I don't really know a more scientific way. What I ended up doing was going to different angles, and I knew roughly that this orange solid from the 2D shot was to be a little bit in front of the chair. I knew I wanted this pink one to be roughly where the back of the chair was, and that the side of the counter would roughly correspond to the front of the desk on that side, and that this green panel here would roughly connect with an object further in the back. So let's change to another view here. So again, it was a matter of just
dragging and scaling and things just roughly lining up so that by the time we got to this, and then you would play out the camera move all the way through, we would end up with a shot where she stayed in that chair and looked like she was at the right scale with the rest of the set.
Magic. I know.
I'm going to focus more on this on the third section, but for now you can see here I have a number of lights that are affecting our element layer and create a much more atmospheric look. But then of course, by the time we get to all this careful lighting, she no longer fits in at all. So one of the things we also have to do with her is to color correct. And so one of the first things I actually wanted to do with the shot was just a little soft for me. So I did an unsharp mask, which was just set to 137. I then did a curves adjustment to create more contrast and to crush the blacks. And then I applied a tritone. Let's close this one up. The tritone was to shift the color scheme and the highlights to reflect more of the blue lighting. And that created this blue cast on her to really start meshing her in with her backdrop. It was kind of a careful balance because I didn't want her to totally vanish, but we still needed to put all the screen graphics in front of her so she couldn't totally stand out as well. And then I did some more sharpening on her as well. Now she looks more like she belongs on that 3D set. One of the next things I added was an adjustment layer that had a glow set to it here. And here is the settings for that. Just to add a little extra touch to the lights around her. And then one of the next things I wanted to do was to have a light that would also still help separate her from the background, because even with the color corrections, and even though I don't want her to stand out too much, she's still the center actress. So I started using Trapcode Lux on some of these lights. And as you can see, by having this strong shaft coming through, that helps separate her as well. But again, I will focus on that more on the third part. Lux is a little complex to use as far as how it works with other layers. It can't both be behind and in front. And I chose instead for her front to actually use a little bit of Trapcode Shine. So I repeated our actress and brought her in front, and then I put shine through her just to create a slight shimmer effect so that as she moved through the shot, it would look like that spotlight behind her was also hitting her on the front and that she was actually breaking up the spotlight a little bit to create a bit of a volumetric look. It's subtle, but it is noticeable. So now it looks like she's breaking up this volumetric light. You've got Lux working on the back part of her. And as you can see, we also have other lights coming through. And then the shine on the front is just making it that much more three-dimensional and really incorporating her into the shot. Now, this red shine that's coming through is meant to be part of the background that's coming through, and we might as well jump to that right now. So way in the backdrop is this. This was a Element 3D project I worked on a while back, inspired by Andrew Kramer's work on Star Trek Into Darkness, and I never really did much with this. In my YouTube channel from a while back, there's like a second and a half of a render of putting this into motion, but not much else. So it was kind of happy to bring this in, even though you're just seeing little bits of it through the window. But it's also kind of nice because it adds a little bit of interest off to the side, and now that red beam coming through makes sense. Okay, let's see what else we added on here. Ah, of course. Now we get to our star players. We have the screen graphics from part one being brought in to this setup. So let's start with
these two graphics with our alien. Now, I did those in two layers, so it just had a little more dimensionality. And then those were made into 3D layers and then scaled and brought in to be right in front of our actress. And then another moment of element 3D was brought in, and those were our holograms that we showed in the first part of the spaceship and the enemy spaceships. And what else? And we've got our planets and our orbits and showing where the distress signal was coming from. And now we will turn on that layer. Here we go. Okay, so here we are with the holograms and the screens all composited in, all in 3D space. So the ship is an element 3D, and the holograms are an additional set of element 3D. These are 2D elements that are brought into place, but they are made into 3D layers. And then the background, because it never moves, is just a flat 2D layer. And then we've got the spotlight, which is kind of a fake 3D effect using Lux and Shine. And boy, what else? I guess the only other thing to mention is the Wheatley robot from Portal. And he is in the ship 3D, element 3D. So let's tap on that. And I was just looking for a drone to just have something interesting in the background, kind of as if she's traveling with this companion, who would kind of be the worrywart character, hoping that she wouldn't go. But so I just found this Wheatley model and did some texturing on it and then brought that in. You can see in this render that he is moving in the background, and of course he's much more prominent in the second shot. The great thing about this shot is that it turns out when you have your thing set on active camera, it turns out that if you have it set on active camera and you actually have it cut from one camera, in this case, you know, my two versions of the first shot camera and second one here, it will naturally cut for you. So the other camera is in a different position, but it works just like moving the camera in a real set, because you're just choosing new coordinates and you're shooting. That way I didn't have to create new animation, new layers, and if I made any last minute changes, I wouldn't have to change both shots. I could just simply have the camera show up in different areas and then have different 2D rotored versions of her appearing in front, and it worked out just fine. I think for now, that's about all we're going to talk about. And so that means we have to move on.
Hi. Well, that wraps things up for part two. Then we are going to go into part three eventually, soon, where I start talking about the finer touches, the set design, the lighting design, sound design. There we go. Those extra touches to elevate the shot to get it look more professional and more polished. And for those of you who think, oh, I'll just skip on over that, I already know, I'm also going to include some bonuses as far as resources and some really great tools that I discovered while I've been working and researching on this. So until then, like, comment, subscribe, all that good stuff, everything that goes on below the screen here. But other than that, see you soon. Thank you, and come again.